Good morning, everyone. It's nice to see everyone here in this worship hall, and welcome to everyone who is joining us online. As our call to worship, let's remind ourselves why we are here today, whether online or in the sanctuary. We start. Christ, who disciples us with love and patience,
we worship you this day.
Christ, whose words plant seeds of faith within us,
we worship you this day.
Christ, who heals, cleanses, and redeems us,
we worship you this day. Come, Lord Jesus Christ, as we arise and praise your name.
So indeed, the Christ that we are here to worship today binds us together. We are co-disciples, co-heirs in Christ, and although the past years have been quite confusing, let us come together and may the peace of Christ rule in our hearts as we are members of one body. And given that, let us pass the peace of Christ to one another in this room. And for you guys online, let's pass the peace of Christ to the people around you at home. And we can also text message. So, peace of Christ. Peace of Christ, everyone. Peace. Peace. Peace of Christ. So, I'm sure the kids went back to school the past week. It has been, I would say, a confusing week in school, maybe at work. And even maybe at home for some of us, with all these guidelines coming up. But through times of uncertainty, isn't it a blessing that we are connected to one solid source of foundation, our foundation and the source of power? I'm reading from Psalm 63, and this is what David said in Psalm 63. And it probably was a time of need for him as well. He says, "You, God, are my God. Earnestly I seek you. I thirst for you. My whole being longs for you in a dry and parched land where there is no water. I have seen you in the sanctuary and beheld your power and your glory. Because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift up my hands. I will be fully satisfied as with the richest of foods. With singing lips, my mouth will praise you." So I invite everyone to stand, and with our lips, let us give praise to this God that we speak about.
To worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth, you created all for love's sake, became to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. I never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. So here I am to worship. Here I am. Altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
The splendor of the King,
clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. Is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God, and
all be seated. Indeed, age to age, he stands, the beginning and the end. With this, let us learn our faith. What is our only comfort in life and death?
That we are not our own, but belong, body and soul, both in life and death, to God and to our Savior, Jesus Christ. He has fully paid for all our sins with his precious blood and watches over us in such a way that not a hair of our heads can fall without the will of our Father in heaven.
So for the Lord our God to even bother with the strands of our hair, I don't know how much of my hair fall off every day, but it speaks of how detailed God is in his care for us. He is trustworthy, and we do not need to second guess his certainty and his intentions. So God, you are the author and perfecter of our faith.
We confess that we have chosen self-reliance over trusting in you.
God, make our faith in you certain and constant.
Forgive us for the times we depend on our own
strength and intellect
and abilities.
And for thinking that the level of our faith is what determines how much you love us.
Open our eyes to see the faith is a gift from you alone.
And teach us not to despise a faith that is as small as a mustard seed,
but to let it take root, grow, and flourish within ourselves and our families, communities, and workplaces.
Let's reflect on this as we go into some time of silent prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
In Ephesians chapter 1, verses 8 to 10, God reminds us that for by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast.
For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them.
Let's all stand again as we sing our song of thanksgiving and
as I pour out my heart these days, faithful God forever.
Lord is faithful in big things and in small things. As we go to our time of Thanksgiving, I'd like to remind everyone that we can still send our offering either by check in person here at church. You can drop it off in the weekdays, or you can also give through e-transfer, and that is through give@icrc.ca. Let's all go to our prayer of thanksgiving. Father, we come before you in humility, Lord, with hearts of thanksgiving, knowing that as we present our offering to you, it's nothing compared, Lord, to everything, to all your provisions from Monday to Sundays, to our families through our work. I pray, Lord, that you will enable us to give cheerfully and to give freely as you have freely given to us. Teach us how to be a blessing to our church, ICRC, and to the people around us in our community. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So our kids can now be dismissed and go to our second floor for Sunday school. I do have some reminders for everyone attending today and online. As you know, that we are following stricter COVID restrictions, so we do ask everyone who is not feeling well, if you have a bit of a sore throat or colds, then we encourage you to just join us online on Sundays. If you are coming to church, whether to be part of the worship team or to preach, we encourage you to register in our church website. So we do have a 90 person limit to attendance for everyone inside the building. Also, we our SALT and our youth Bible class has resumed last week. For SALT, there is an option for the youth to join by Discord. So if you are interested and if you cannot come to the church physically, then please, and you need the link, please please email salt@icrc.ca. So there is a hybrid meeting going on where they can do physical meeting as well as do it online. And for our youth Bible class, we have that in person every Sunday at 10:30 a.m. at the ground floor of the parsonage. And with that, we'll ask Pastor Vic to come preach to us today.
Thank you, Kathy, for leading us in worship. I want to extend a warm welcome to all of you who are here today, both those of you who are joining us here in person as well as online. We're glad that you've taken the time to worship with us here at Emmanuel CRC. Now, our passage today is taken from Luke chapter 17, verses 1 to 19, where Jesus is speaking to his disciples, and it reads, "And he said to his disciples, temptations to sin are sure to come, but woe to the one through whom they come. It would be better for him if a millstone were hung around his neck and he were cast into the sea, than that he should cause one of these little ones to sin. Pay attention to yourselves. If your brother sins, rebuke him. And if he repents, forgive him. And if he sins against you seven times in the day and turns to you seven times saying, I repent, you must forgive him." The apostle said to the Lord, "Increase our faith." And the Lord said, "If you had faith like a grain of mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it would obey you. Will any one of you who has a servant plowing or keeping sheep say to him when he has come in from the field, come in at once and recline at the table? Will he not rather say to him, prepare supper for me and dress properly and serve me while I eat and drink, and afterward you will eat and drink? Does he thank the servant because he did what was commanded? So you also, when you have done all that you were commanded, say, we are unworthy servants, we have only done what was our duty." And on the way to Jerusalem, on the way, he was passing along between Samaria and Galilee, and as he entered a village, he was met by 10 lepers who stood at a distance and lifted up their voices, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." And when he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were cleansed. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, he turned back, praising God with a loud voice, and he fell on his face at Jesus' feet, giving him thanks. Now he was a Samaritan. And Jesus answered, "Were not 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? Was no one found to return to give praise to God except this foreigner?" And he said to him, "Rise and go on your way. Your faith has made you well." This is the word of the Lord. Jesus says, "Your faith has made you well." Scientists and theologians have tried over the centuries to understand the impact of faith on a person's well-being. Instinctively, those of us who have faith in God, we know that there is a connection. We understand that our faith provides us structure and meaning. It helps us to find meaningful answers to age-old questions like, what is the ultimate reality? Who am I? Why am I here? What does human flourishing look like? And where do I go from here? So it's no surprise that research into connection between faith and well-being demonstrate a clear linkage. Faith in God is associated with well-being, and in a positive way. This is what researchers at the Mayo Clinic had to say. Most studies have shown that religious involvement and spirituality are associated with better health outcomes, including greater longevity, coping skills, health-related quality of life, even during terminal illness, and less anxiety and depression. I also have the quotation up on the screen. So for example, this study looked at three other longitudinal studies conducted over many years, which showed that those who attended weekly religious services were between 23 to 28% less likely than non-attenders to die. It seems like if you want to live longer, maybe come to church every week. So the research supports our intuitions that faith improves a person's well-being, improves their physical and mental health. But is that all that Jesus meant when he said, "Your faith has made you well"? I want to say today that it is not simply any kind of faith, but a faith of a certain kind of faith that makes one completely well. And today we're going to study this passage to look at this kind of faith. What is faith? You know, I think Hebrews 11 is that defining chapter in the Bible which talks to us, which tells us what faith is about. So faith is something that's hard to describe, it's impossible to quantify, but when it's present, it's obvious, it packs a punch, it changes the world. A scriptural definition can be found in verse 1, right? It says, "Faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen." So it's not something that can be measured empirically. You know, there's no scale or gauge or sensor or meter to test someone's faith. There isn't. That's why researchers use weekly attendance as a proxy. They have no way of kind of figuring out how much faith, or is there any faith. So they go, oh, you know, well, how else do we measure? They measure weekly attendance, right? But faith has a discernible effect. It doesn't only extend life or improve well-being. Those who have faith have assurance of things hoped for, of things not seen. Now, this world would say that seeing is believing, right? You know, show me the proof, show me the money, and then I'll believe. But for those of us who understand faith, those of us who have lived and experienced faith, believing is seeing. It's the other way around. Faith is the means by which we perceive God. Faith is the means by which we accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. Faith provides us with the capacity to live life to the fullest according to God's design. In fact, without faith, humans are limited to sight, smell, hearing, touch, and taste. But faith is absolutely crucial in the way that we experience God. It's a whole different way of sensing. I tell you the truth, believing is seeing. In fact, without faith, there's no way that humans can live the full, flourishing life that God has designed for us. Hebrews 11:6 puts it this way: without faith, it is impossible to please Him, impossible to please God. For whoever would draw near to God must believe that He exists and that He rewards those who seek Him. Without faith, we wouldn't believe that God exists. We wouldn't believe that He rewards those who seek Him. We wouldn't seek God. We certainly wouldn't draw near to Him. Without faith, we cannot be made well. We cannot be made well. So as we go through today's passage, we'll see how this certain kind of faith operates. The kind of faith that makes one totally well, recognizes the impossible, reaches out to God, responds in active obedience, and then finally returns to glorify God. Right? So recognizing the impossible, in the first two verses, Jesus speaks to his disciples, but he's warning them against behaving like the Pharisees. In fact, this is one of the recurrent themes as Jesus disciples those who follow him on the way to Jerusalem. The religious elite have interpreted God's word in such a strict and rigorous way. They've made it so hard for people to follow that ordinary people are saying, it's too hard. Maybe I just won't follow God. Maybe I'll just disobey because it's so hard. They've been imposing so many requirements that Jews have been stumbled. They've been misled to think that the Pharisees' way of life is the only way. And because of that, many have decided that it's better to simply disregard God's word. It's easier, better to sin instead of obeying God. And Jesus uses the strongest language here in his rebuke. It would be better for a millstone to be hung around the neck of someone like this, cast into the sea, rather than causing little ones to walk away from God. And then in verses 3 and 4, he turns the focus back on his disciples. They also need to pay attention to themselves. If your brother sins, rebuke him. If he repents, forgive him. But before we go any further, I'd like for us to think of a time when perhaps you were upset at someone, when someone had caused you grief, when someone had sinned against you. Who's this person? Where did it take place? Perhaps at work, at school, maybe at home, or in church. And what was your response? Now, hold on to that mental image as we look at verses 3 and 4, right? Notice Jesus did not say, if someone sins against you, just grin and bear with it, right? In Singlish, we say, just tahan. And I think in Tagalog, taan also means, you know, to hold back, to not fully let go, right? Jesus didn't say, just grin and bear with it. If someone sins against us, we are to rebuke them. Now, for those of us who tend to avoid conflict, taking someone to task can be quite nerve-wracking, right? Especially if we're upset or angry, you know, because we want to preserve the underlying relationship, but then we're not feeling so good, so we want to let the other person know. But when the wave of anger or frustration has passed, and we need to talk about these actions, these words that have hurt us or caused us grief, and then we give the person the space to respond. And then there's some of us for whom, you know, we don't avoid conflict, right? Rebuking someone who has caused us grief is not difficult in itself for us. But perhaps in the course of doing so, relationships could be strained, right? We might have rebuked people in a way that perhaps have closed the door to the other person and denied them the space to reconsider, come back to us, to apologize to us. Or we might have rebuked them in a way that also caused them hurt, right? While rebuke is necessary, we have to do it in a way so as to preserve the relationship, to give the other person space for restoration and repentance. But regardless of whether we are conflict averse or not, we're called to forgive, all right? And that's whether or not the other person repents. Well, you say to me, but Vic, the passage here says, if he repents, forgive, right? And that's true. But consider also Matthew 18:21-22. Peter came to Jesus and asked, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Up to 7 times? And Jesus answered, I tell you, not 7 times, but 77 times. And here in this passage, there's no account of the other person repenting or saying that they're sorry, right? By the way, Matthew 18 is an invaluable resource because Jesus also gives guidance for conflict resolution within the church. 7 times in one day. 77 times. This is a hard teaching. Now think back on that person that you find difficult to forgive. Perhaps they might have wronged you once. Perhaps they might have wronged you more than once, many times. Jesus is calling on you to forgive, to let go of that hurt, to let go of that anger, to let go of the desire to retaliate, and to forgive. Let that sink in for a minute. God, who forgave us of all our sins and unrighteousness, is also calling us to forgive. Now, perhaps for some of us in our hearts, we're thinking, Vic, what you're asking for is too much. It's impossible. I can't do it, at least not for now. Well, take heart, you're not alone. I certainly feel like that sometimes. And the disciples, they responded to Jesus also. They also felt that way. They go to Jesus and they say, increase our faith. We can't do this, basically. Increase our faith. They recognized that it was impossible for them to do what Jesus was saying. They recognize a certain deficiency in their ability to obey, but they connected this deficiency to an insufficient amount of faith. So Jesus replied, if you had faith like a grain of mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it would obey you. Now, when we studied Luke 13 together the last time, Jesus had already talked about the mustard seed, right? As a picture for what the kingdom looks like. It starts small, it goes deep, and it changes everything. So when Jesus talks about faith using that same mustard seed, he's actually responding to the disciples' request to increase their faith. And for those of you who like Asian food, we can extend the analogy to chili peppers, all right? Some of you will know that the hottest chili peppers are not exactly the largest ones, right? It's not the size that counts. It's the smaller ones that pack the greatest punch. It's the siling laboyo, or the wild chili in the Philippines. In Singapore, we also have the chili padi, which is also known as the bird's eye chili. Even if you have a little bit of it in your food, you will know that it's there. Especially the seeds. Oh my gosh, what an effect that has. It starts small, it goes deep, and it changes everything. And if it's there, immediately you'll know it. So when Jesus responds in this way in verse 6, he's saying that there's something wrong about their request, and there's also something right about their request. The disciples assume that their faith is insufficient. It's not enough. But Jesus' response is that it's not a matter of power, but of presence. Not a matter of extent, but existence. As long as faith exists, as long as the right kind of faith exists, all you need is a little bit. And then what seems impossible becomes possible. The tree that Jesus is talking about is actually known to be a tree with very deep roots, okay? So when his listeners are hearing him talk about the mulberry tree, they can't even imagine a mulberry tree moving 1 inch, not to mention into the sea. It's like that's impossible. But what Jesus is saying is, as long as faith exists, you don't need a lot of it. As long as it exists, disciples will be able to do the impossible. To forgive 7 times, to forgive 77 times, that would be possible. So if you're finding that in your life there's an area that's particularly difficult to believe in God, to trust and obey in Him, you don't have to pray for more faith. You don't have to pray for bigger faith. Simply ask God to give even a little bit of faith in that area of struggle. But notice also that Jesus does not redirect his request somewhere, right? We've talked about what was wrong about the disciples' request. Now we're going to talk about what was right about the disciples' request. He doesn't redirect this request somewhere else. He doesn't say to the disciples, oh, don't ask me, ask someone else. He doesn't. He responds to them. And in directing this request to Jesus, in directing this request to the Lord, the disciples have done the right thing. They recognize their deficiency, their inability to follow God, to rebuke and to forgive. And so they make this request to Jesus, the Lord, for help. In responding to them, Jesus is saying that he's the right person for the disciples to direct this request to. When we recognize that there are situations where it seems impossible to follow God, we are to reach out to God. That's what the disciples did. That was right. Reach out to God. They were asking the right person, just not asking for the right thing. So for those of us who feel like somehow our faith is insufficient, you know, I want to encourage you. There is no scale or meter that we can measure our faith. There's no dynamo that we can crank to increase the level of our faith. There's no pump that we can pump to operate to increase the volume of our faith. Faith is something that first and foremost comes from God. It's not something we can generate by ourselves apart from God. And some of us will have doubts from time to time. That's normal, especially when we experience things in life that are challenging, that seem to contradict our understanding of who God is. But if that happens, let us be like that father of the boy afflicted by an unclean spirit in Mark 9. So the father describes his son's affliction to Jesus and says to Jesus, if you can do anything, have compassion on us. Help us. And Jesus said to him, if you can. All things are possible for one who believes. And the Father cries out, I believe, help my unbelief. I believe, help my unbelief. Right? It's like a contradiction right there. But isn't that how life is sometimes? Right? We humans, we're not straightforward, you know? Sometimes we feel two things at one time. Sometimes we feel like, yeah, we believe. But maybe in one particular area, oh, so hard to believe. I believe. Help my unbelief. In some situations, perhaps we have faith in God. In other situations, perhaps we doubt God. Today, if you find yourself in that kind of a difficult situation, we can pray like this man. I believe. Help my unbelief. Now, I'm aware of some situations that seem chronic and dysfunctional beyond repair. Right? For some of us, it could be a spouse or children or parents or siblings who don't want to believe in God. For others, it could be a friend or a loved one who keeps on causing hurt or causing grief. It could be someone in the marketplace, at work, in school, at home, in the church, you know, who continues to cause grief. But we can pray this way, just as the father of that boy did. I believe in you. Help my unbelief. Help me to forgive. Bring them back to you. Also, I do want to qualify this somehow. If you are physically in danger of being hurt, if your life is being threatened, you need to speak to someone that you trust. All right? Scripture holds God-given life as something sacred. And when life and limb are in danger, you need to speak to someone you trust and move into a different space from the person causing you physical harm or threatening your life. All right? Move there until you can be sure that there is no further danger to your life. Now, there may be a time to work through the rebuking and the forgiving as the Lord allows later, but first, talk to someone and move away. Is that okay? Now, in the next portion, we're moving on to the third part of our sermon today. In the next portion, verses 7 to 10 speak about an active obedience that is without expectation of reward. Here, Jesus is actually indirectly rebuking the Pharisees who make an ostentatious show, you know, a huge show of their outward obedience to God, but all the while actually expecting rewards both from God and praises from men. And he's also warning disciples against this kind of obedience because true obedience can only come from a faith that's rightly oriented towards God, one that is without expectation. And then in verses 11 to 19, we have the story of the 10 lepers. Although it seems like a separate section altogether, it seems like it's not connected. Actually, this passage also has something significant to say about faith. Now, when we're reading this passage or this section, we notice, first of all, that the lepers stand at a distance. Right? They stand at a distance because they're unwell. They're stricken with leprosy. It's this disease that causes the skin to form lesions, which can become quite obvious. It affects the nerves, especially in the arms and the legs. And when it progresses, people are unable to walk, to move, and gradually become paralyzed. We know today that this is caused by a type of bacteria that's spread by droplets in the person's breath. It's not as infectious as COVID. You know, maybe only 1 in 10 people who have leprosy at any one time are infectious. And sometimes the body's immune system is able to overcome the infection, right? So it's not as serious. But because it's infectious, there are specific laws in Leviticus 13 to 14. We won't go through them today, but it's there if you want to take a look at it, to help manage this disease. So people who noticed sores on their skins were to go before the priests, and if the priests identified the sores to be caused by leprosy, the affected persons would have to isolate for 14 days. Okay, so in the Old Testament, there's this concept of quarantine way before us, okay? Way before us. And if they continue to have the disease, they are to stay away from the community and cry out unclean, unclean, to warn others to stay away. Today we say positive, positive. When Jesus enters this village, you know, so these 10 lepers come to him straight away. They maintain social distance. They say to him, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. In this one sentence, They already have done the two things that we talked about. They've recognized that they were unable to heal themselves, so they recognized the impossible, and they recognized that Jesus had the authority to heal them. Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. So far, when they reach out to Jesus, they are two for two, right? They recognize the impossible, they reach out to Jesus. But Jesus does not heal them immediately. He simply says, go and show yourselves to the priests. So typically, people who have leprosy after 14 days, if they still continue to have leprosy, you know, they would be set aside from the community. Now, if somehow they are healed, they are to go back to the priests, you know, for an examination. But Scripture makes it clear that when Jesus says, go and show, at that point, they are not healed. I imagine with my sanctified imagination that, you know, the lepers, they initially hesitate. Maybe Jesus is just brushing them off. You know, go and show yourself. So maybe he's just brushing them off. Maybe this is his way of getting rid of them. Or maybe he's even pranking them. You know, go and show, and they go and show, but it's still, the leprosy is still there, and they still have that disease. They're still cut off from their loved ones. They're still cut off from community. They can't earn any income. They're physically disfigured, and eventually, they become paralyzed. They cannot move independently, and they die alone. But one of them turns. One of them turns, and starts to walk. And before you know it, the others, one by one, they start to turn. I mean, think about it. They've got nothing to lose. Go and show. Okay, let's go and let's show. But as they turned, something happened. The skin lesions disappeared. As they turned, those who had decreased sensation in their arms and legs, they started to feel them again. They started to walk more purposefully. They started to stride more quickly, more confidently. Suddenly, they could walk quickly without tripping. They did not see. They did not wait until they saw the result, you see. When Jesus said, go and show, they turned. They believed first, and then they saw themselves get healed. You see that? Believing is seeing. And so I say again, the world may say that seeing is believing, but for those of us who have faith in God, believing is seeing. Believing is our way of experiencing the fullest life that God has designed for us to live. When we believe, we enter into this God-given experience of well-being, of wholeness that others who do not have faith will not experience. So far, the lepers are three for three. All right, so they've recognized the impossible, they've reached out to God, and they've responded in active obedience. But there's one more element for the certain kind of faith that we're talking about today. Now, of the 10 lepers who are healed, only one returns to praise God, to fall at Jesus' feet, and to give him thanks. Only one. Verse 16 tells us that he was a Samaritan. And it's clear from the passage that there were at least both Jews and Samaritans in this group of lepers, but only the Samaritan returns to glorify God. This Samaritan is the ultimate outcast. Okay, on the one hand, he's cut off from his loved ones and community because he has leprosy. But on the other hand, he's also shunned by Jews because of a long-standing conflict between Jews and Samaritans. He's the ultimate outcast. But I think sometimes it's the ones on the margins of society who are most sensitive to the gospel. It's the ones who are shunned and avoided by others that recognize the power of the gospel first. They are the ones who demonstrate the kind of faith that recognizes the impossible, reaches out to God, responds in active obedience, and returns to glorify God. Of the 10 lepers who are healed, 9 are satisfied with the restoration of their physical well-being. And they proceed without a backward glance at the source of their well-being. 9 are happy to receive the gift of healing, but not to acknowledge the giver of their healing. Of the 10, only one turns, and only one hears these words, "Rise and go your way. Your faith has made you well." Your faith has made you well. Now, some translations will render this phrase, "Your faith has healed you." Other translations will say, "Your faith has saved you," you know, or "has made you well," or "has made you whole." And these things sound quite different, right? It's like, so which translation do we trust? Which is the better one? Well, the Greek word here is the word sozo. And this word has been used in Scripture in two ways, all right? The first way is to talk about preserving or rescuing from death and disease. And the second way is talking about saving or preserving from eternal death. So in the immediate context, Jesus saves all 10 lepers from disease. So most translations will say either "your faith has made you well" or "your faith has healed you." That's correct. But I think the second meaning, "your faith has saved you from eternal death," also applies to this Samaritan who was healed. 9 are healed in the first sense of the word sozo, but it is the 10th leper that is fully made whole in both senses of the word. So when Jesus declares, "Your faith has sozoed you," I think Jesus means both that this man has been physically made whole and that his relationship with God has been restored. So that's why I think the best translations render this phrase either "made well" or "made whole," because that kind of represents both senses of the word. So at the beginning, I talked about studies that show a correlation between spirituality or faith and well-being, right? But these studies are confined only to the first meaning of sozo, of being made whole or being healed. After all, these studies are not able to evaluate a person's relationship with God or handle concepts like eternal life. So they stay focused on health outcomes that are measurable, right? And while it's true in general that faith provides improved well-being, these studies are not equipped to grasp the second meaning of sozo, of being saved from eternal death, of having a right relationship with God. But you and I, anyone today who reads this passage, we know the way. This certain kind of faith is the kind of faith that first recognizes the impossible, second reaches out to God, third responds in active obedience, and fourth returns to glorify God. This is the certain kind of faith that truly saves, that truly makes whole. So today, as your pastor, as someone who stands in the gap and prays on your behalf, I want to pray with all of you, those who are present here in person, as well as those who are joining us online. I'm going to pray that in this new year, in 2022, the Lord our God will cause faith to burst forth in your lives. I'm going to pray for God to give us that certain kind of faith that makes us whole, that makes us completely well, totally whole. The kind of faith that heals, the kind of faith that saves for eternity. Would you join with me in prayer? Father in heaven, we come to you today, recognizing that without faith, it's impossible to live the abundant life that you have called us to. We recognize that in some areas of our lives, we struggle to obey you, whether it is forgiving someone who has hurt us or obeying you before we see the changes that we are hoping for. Lord, we believe. Help our unbelief. Forgive us where we lack faith and cause faith to burst forth afresh and anew in us. For you, O Lord, are the author and the perfecter of our faith. Our faith begins in you and is made complete in you, O God. Spirit of God, we ask that you help us to choose rightly. Help us to respond in active obedience, even before we see the things we are hoping for, because we trust in your character. You are compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, maintaining love to thousands, and forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin. How many times have you saved us from disaster? How many times have you preserved us from falling? For each and every time that you rescued us, the times that we know about and the times that we don't, we turn to you in gratitude. We glorify your name. We lift up your name and we declare that you alone are worthy to receive glory and honor and power both now and forever. Amen.
Let's all stand.
Upon your name, above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine.
Hands in a posture of reception and receive this benediction. May the Father strengthen you with power through His Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And may you, being rooted and grounded in love, have strength to comprehend with all the Lord's holy people how wide, how long, how high, how deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to Him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to Him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. I invite you to be seated. The service is now over, but take a minute to reflect and be quiet, and then you're welcome to leave.